Eswar Prasad is the Tolani Senior Professor of Trade Policy at Cornell University, a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution, and a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research. He's a former head of the IMF's China division. Today he'll be talking about his new book, The Dollar Trap, explaining why, despite the global financial crisis, the dollar is poised to remain the ultimate safe haven currency. As the Financial Times put it, to understand how the world of international finance works, what the agendas are, and what is at stake, this work is indispensable. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Eswar Prasad.
This is, of course, the dream of every writer, to give a talk at Politics in Prose. I've written many incomprehensible technical books in my lifetime, but it took my writing what I hope is at least a semi-comprehensible book to make it here. So I'm very happy to be standing before you. How comprehensible it is of course up to you, but one's family is one's harshest critic, and my wife did pay me the ultimate compliment because we were at dinner soon after I'd finished the book, and she actually read through the book, poor thing, and my friends, of course, when they heard it was an economics book, they were polite, but you could sense them rolling their eyes. So my wife very stoutly went to my defense. She said, you know, it's really not that bad. I hope you find it to be a little more than that at least. So actually, it did start out as a somewhat technical and boring book. There are many things that excite us economists and probably not too many others, but there are some interesting paradoxes already in international finance. One, for instance, is the fact that capital, money, flows from poor to the rich countries, which is a little odd. You would expect that according to theory and according to logic, money should flow from the richer countries where there is a lot more of it and less labor to countries where there is a lot more labor and less capital. It turns out it doesn't work that way. The US and China are, of course, prime examples. The US has been borrowing a lot from the rest of the world, while China, a middle-income country, has been exporting capital to the rest of the world, especially the US. It's not just the US and China. It turns out there's a lot more to this story. But as I started looking through this and other paradoxes that I plan to write about based on my own research, through the lens of the financial crisis, a much more interesting story came into focus. So that's the story that is in The Dollar Trap. And it's a story that's rich with twists and turns and many, many paradoxes, as you will see. Consider this. The global financial crisis had its origins here in the United States. Since the crisis, the United States has issued a massive amount of public debt. In addition, the US Federal Reserve has effectively pumped a huge amount of dollars into the global financial system. Now, with a lot more dollars floating around, what would you expect? You would expect, according to logic, that the dollar's value should decline and the dollar should lose its prominence as a global reserve currency. What happened? It turns out that the value of the dollar, in a very broad sense relative to all the major trading partners of the US, is roughly where it is today, as it was back in 2007. There have been ups and downs, but the dollar didn't lose significantly in value. And the other thing is this huge amount of public debt that the US issued. Let's set aside the amount bought by the Federal Reserve and by other parts of the US government. The amount of publicly traded debt issued by the US since the end of 2007 is about $5.7 trillion. That's more than a doubling of the publicly traded debt. And who bought the stuff? It turns out that foreign investors purchased nearly $3.5 trillion, or 60% of this debt. Debt of a country that was amassing huge amounts of it and where the financial crisis started, which is a little odd. Now, let's take more recent history, October 2013, when the US came to the brink of a default. Now, it was highly unlikely that the US would actually default in its debt. It may have been a short-lived technical default, but there was a moment when our good Senator Ted Cruz was on the floor of the Senate reading Green Eggs and Ham, when there was a distinct possibility that the US might at least technically default in its debt. What happens usually when there is a prospect of either a corporation or a country defaulting on its debt? People fly out of that debt, start charging much higher interest rates if that corporation or government wants people to buy its debt, and you would expect the value of the dollar to decline. What happened? It turns out that some things did go according to plan. the yield on the 1 month and 3 month Treasury bonds actually did rise. It rose from about 0.01% to about 0.1% at an annual rate, which means that even though this was the instrument that was expected to default, for the privilege of holding $100 of debt, the US government at the end of 1 year would give you $100.10. And what happened to all this money that went out of short-term US treasuries? It went into longer-term US treasury securities. So the yields on the 10-year government bond actually declined, which is remarkable given that there was a prospect of the US defaulting on its debt. People were giving money to the US more cheaply. And what happened to the dollar? If anything, it strengthened a little bit while all of this was going on. Now, it turns out these are not isolated events. Since the financial crisis, every time there is turmoil anywhere in the world, in emerging markets, in the Eurozone, or, and this is the great paradox, in the US itself, money comes to the US in search of safety. This is a really bizarre world we live in. It turns out that we economists like to simplify things, and ultimately, as with much else in economics, the story hinges on supply and demand. Supply and demand of one specific thing, financial safe assets. Now, what are financial safe assets? Essentially, these are assets where you expect to at least maintain the value of your principal and that are relatively liquid or easy to trade. And what financial assets have these characteristics? By and large, government bonds of the advanced economies. So let's see what happened on the demand side. Since the financial crisis, emerging market countries in particular have felt this desire to protect themselves from capital flow volatility, from currency volatility. How do you do that? You build up a lot of hard currency reserves. Hard currency reserves are essentially reserves held in the currencies of the major advanced economies so that if a country like India finds its currency coming under pressure, it can sell the dollars and get money to pay off its imports, pay for its debts, and that would reduce the pressure on the currency. So demand from emerging markets has soared. Private investors want more safety in times of turmoil, and financial institutions, banks, are being asked to hold a lot more financial safe assets because the fact that they didn't have much when the financial crisis hit meant that they had liquidity problems, and we want to avoid that from happening. So the demand has surged. And what happened on the supply side? We know now that the Eurozone ain't quite what it used to be. We know there is a big difference between a Greek bond and a German Bund. We used to see the Eurozone as essentially one zone altogether. So now, when we think about what we might consider the safe part of the Eurozone, that accounts for only about 40% of Eurozone debt. And even that 40% includes countries like Austria and France that have had downgrades of their debt. So there isn't as much safe assets available from the Eurozone anymore. There are traditional safe havens like Japan and Switzerland that don't want money coming into their economies because that would lead to the value of their currencies appreciating and their exports would become less competitive. So what are they doing? Instead of being net suppliers of safe assets, they have become net demanders of safe assets. And then private sector securities are not considered safe anymore in the aftermath of the crisis because even some rock solid corporations ran into lots of financial trouble. So basically, that's what the story boils down to. A surge in the demand for financial safe assets, a huge decline in the supply, and who's left to fill in the balance? The US. And the US has been doing its service to the world by generating massive amounts of public debt that the world can hold. Now, this seems like a game that is rigged in favor of the US. It turns out even for the US, it's a mixed blessing. It is true, a stronger dollar means that we can buy Chinese stuff more cheaply. It also means that the world is willing to give us very cheap financing for buying stuff from the rest of the world. That's a pretty good deal. Of course, the downside is that a strong dollar means that there is less export growth from the US, and that means less job growth. And especially at a time like this when every little bit helps, certainly that's not helping the labor market. But I think the bigger problem is a much more insidious one, which is that the US is able to run policies that ultimately might not be in its own best interest or in the interest of the world. Why? because the world doesn't discipline us. When there is turmoil created by US policies, the world comes to the US for safety. So why would the US be much more careful about its policies? So again, the level of bizarreness seems to be ascending with every proposition I take you through. So one immediate question at this stage is, why aren't there alternatives? Why are we stuck with a system where the US remains so dominant despite policies in the US that might not seem ideal for the US or for the rest of the world? The euro was considered a viable competitor to the dollar in the early years of its inception. In 1999, when the euro was created, all the currencies that together went into the euro, they accounted for about 23% of global foreign exchange reserves. Those were held in currencies like the German mark and the French franc and a few other currencies that eventually became part of the euro. Now, the euro share in global foreign exchange reserves actually increased to about 28% by 2004. And it took this out of the dollar share. So the dollar share in global FX reserves was going like this, the euro share was going like this, and many people were extrapolating that this would happen, that the euro would take over, because after all, the eurozone had as much GDP as the US, and in that period in the early 2000s, when the US was going through a tech bubble crash, Europe seemed to be doing somewhat better. But by 2004, the share of the euro flatlined. Essentially, it turned out that the eurozone financial markets were not quite as deep or liquid as the US. They didn't have as much debt or as much turnover in those markets, so investors didn't feel that comfortable going there, at least relatively speaking. It's possible that the eurozone could again become a viable competitor. Now, that would take significant steps towards true economic union, not just monetary union, but also banking union and fiscal union, so that the eurozone behaves like a true economic zone, rather than just one tied together by a common central bank. So I've just been touring through Europe, and I can tell you that while everybody signs on to this notion of an economic union, the view is very different in Frankfurt than it is in the periphery economies. It could happen. I'm not counting on it. Then consider the Chinese renminbi. Now, this is a very alluring story because, after all, China's economy has been growing very fast and on its present growth trajectory, if they don't stumble, and I suspect they'll make it through without stumbling, by the next decade or 15 years, the Chinese economy could be as big as the US economy. And size is certainly important. So, in fact, many people have been arguing that perhaps the renminbi is going to take over from the dollar. Now, it's useful to think about different concepts here when you talk about currencies. One is as an international currency, a currency that is used to settle trade and finance transactions. And there, actually, the renminbi is beginning to gain some traction because, after all, China now accounts for about 10% of global trade, a similar amount of global GDP, depending on how you measure it. It's a couple of percentage points higher or lower. But China is clearly becoming a great power and a great trading power. So the renminbi is getting traction as an international currency. Now, to be a reserve currency, you need a few more things. You need to have an open capital account. You need a flexible exchange rate that is determined by markets and deep financial markets. Now, these are important because if you think about the renminbi becoming a reserve currency, foreign investors need to have access to renminbi assets that they can get, and they need to be able to move freely in and out of those assets. So that's what an open capital account means, that there are no restrictions on capital flows across borders. Now, China is actually moving forward in all of these dimensions, very slowly, in its own measured way, but it is moving forward. Now, the remarkable thing is that although China does not meet these prerequisites, it turns out that the renminbi is already a reserve currency. There are some countries, Latin American countries like Chile, African countries like Nigeria, and a whole host of Asian countries like Korea, Malaysia, Thailand, Japan, that have all said they already hold some renminbi in their reserve portfolio or plan to. Now, why does this make sense? This is not a currency that is freely traded. There are very few renminbi assets. Why are these countries actually holding their foreign currency reserves in renminbi? Many have argued that this suggests that the renminbi is inevitably going to take over. After all, if the renminbi does not meet the prerequisites and is already a reserve currency, surely when all the prerequisites are met, it's home free. Now, it turns out that all of these I interpret in my book as essentially a low-cost bet on a country that is becoming very important in international trade and finance. And it makes sense from a diversification perspective for countries, central banks, to hold a little bit of renminbi. In addition, everybody wants to be friends with China, especially Asian economies, because it's a very important trading partner. And it turns out that all the countries I've mentioned do have very strong trading relationships with China. Then comes another concept, which is where the difference lies between the US dollar and the renminbi. So we've talked about an international currency, we've talked about a reserve currency, but then there is the concept of a safe haven currency, a currency that investors are willing to go to for safety of their investments. Now there, it's worth thinking a little bit about why it is that the US still remains in this dominant position. Now, the US has size. It's the largest economy in the world by far. It's a very dynamic and resilient economy. And the US has very deep financial markets. But I argue in the book there is something much more important that is necessary to back up a safe haven currency: institutions. Now, what do I mean by institutions? First of all, an open and transparent democratic structure. Now, we all live in Washington, and of course, you might think I'm completely delusional to argue that the US political system is working well. But it turns out that this is not the first time our senators and congressmen have behaved badly towards each other. They literally hit each other over the head. I'm sure there are books here at Politics and Prose that lay out the travails that our Congress have been through. But what is important is that there is, I hope, a self-correcting mechanism that gets policies right over time. And more importantly, there is an institutionalized system of checks and balances among the executive, legislative, and judicial branches of government. That's one. The second factor is trusted public institutions, including a central bank, the Federal Reserve, that the world seems willing to trust. And third, an independent judiciary. Now, why does this matter? It turns out that right now, if you look at the US debt numbers, the amount of gross debt in the US, gross public debt, is about $17.4 trillion. The US Federal Reserve has purchased about $2 trillion of those. About $5 trillion is held by the US Social Security Trust Funds. So the amount of publicly traded debt, the residual, is about $10.2 trillion. Of that $10.2 trillion, $5.7 trillion, about 55%, is held by foreign investors. Now, this share is much greater than other reserve currency economies. In Japan's case, about 11% of net debt is held by foreign investors. In the case of the Eurozone, it's about 15 to 17%. In the case of the UK and Switzerland, it's about 30%. So the US stands out, and it seems like the perfect opportunity to soak foreign investors. How could you do this? You could generate a burst of inflation in the US, which would hurt all bondholders, because if you have more inflation, the price of the bond falls. Foreign investors would get doubly hurt, because not only would they lose in terms of the value of their bond holdings, but the dollar would almost certainly depreciate against other currencies. So if you think about China holding a lot of US government securities, the value in the Chinese currency, the renminbi, of these holdings would decline. So it's a double whammy. Why are foreign investors buying into this apparent con game? Now, it turns out from the perspective of foreign investors, who holds this $4.5 trillion turns out to be really important. It's largely fixed income investors, including many pensioners and retirees, many of whom happen to live in Florida, an important swing state in the US political process. It belongs to state and local governments, and it's held by insurance companies and other institutional investors, all of whom are politically very, very powerful. So from the point of view of the foreign investor, it's not that inflation is unlikely in the US, high inflation as a way of reducing the real value of the debt, but it becomes much less likely because of this political system, because the incumbent government would have a very large price to pay if it used inflation as a strategy to pay down the value of the debt. What about soaking foreign investors disproportionately? Couldn't the US just say, we will not pay back part of China's debt or part of Russia's debt? It turns out here the legal system becomes very important, because statutorily the US cannot discriminate among different classes of bondholders. And this is very important because, again, the independent legal system means that the US government has to play by the same rules. There aren't that many countries in the world where the government gets taken to court, and frequently the government loses. So you may not like the rules and regulations, but everybody, including the US government, has to play by these rules. And in my book, I argue that these are really the underpinnings of what the US has put together. And if you look at the other safe haven currencies like the euro, the Japanese yen, the Swiss franc, which is a very small country, but all of these are backed by powerful institutions. And this is why I think the renminbi is not going to in any way challenge the US dollar's dominance. Because if you think about what China is trying to do and what its leaders have abundantly made clear, there are going to be economic and financial market reforms which will make the renminbi in due course a reserve currency. But to be a safe haven currency, I argue that you need powerful institutions, and China would need legal, political, and institutional reforms that, at least in the present course, I don't see them undertaking. So my sense is that the renminbi will erode to some extent the dollar's dominance, but not really challenge it. Now, at this stage, again, it seems that the world is stuck with the dollar to some extent. So as an aspiring public intellectual, it is incumbent on me to lay out a scenario where this thing comes apart, because all I've told you so far suggests that this is a very bizarre situation. When the US creates turmoil, everybody comes to the US for safety. Surely something is wrong here, and there must be a way that this ends. So I tried. I tried very hard, because I knew that it would not only help book sales, but help my standing as a public intellectual if I could lay out a disaster scenario, how this whole thing would come apart, and then you would all come and pay obeisance to me when that happened, because I would have foretold the end. Now, one thing that financial crises have taught us is that we often get blindsided by shocks that we didn't anticipate, or, as the financial crisis made abundantly clear, we may have anticipated certain shocks like the housing market problems in the US, but the fact that they would cascade and become such a tsunami we may not have anticipated. So in the book, I go through various tipping point scenarios. China officially holds about $1.3 trillion worth of US Treasury securities. So maybe China will say, I don't like US policy towards Taiwan or Tibet. I'm going to teach the US a lesson. I know it'll hurt me, but it's worth paying this price. Maybe Russia, as it has been threatening to do, could take its reserve holdings in US dollars and go home. You don't even need external agents. Right now, as I said, there's an enormous amount of liquidity or dollars floating around in the financial system. You have a huge amount of public debt being accumulated, but the expectations of future inflation, which tend to be very related to these two things, has remained remarkably tame. One fine morning, bond investors, including some of us, might wake up and say, oh my God, this is going to end and I better get out of US Treasury bonds, because there's going to be a spike in inflation and the value of those bonds is going to fall. If some people start thinking like this, there may be a cascading effect. Other bond investors start panicking and soon you have turmoil. Now, in every one of these tipping point scenarios, it turns out there is one common theme. You will have turmoil in US government bond markets. And these are the deepest markets in the world, seen as the safest, and they act as the benchmark for other financial markets. So US equity markets, corporate paper markets will all start experiencing turmoil. And again, a lesson from the financial crisis, if there is turmoil in US financial markets, given how important they are for the world, this will infect the rest of the world very quickly. And what happens when there is turmoil? We are all desperate for safety. And where do you go for safety? Back to the US dollar, simply because there is no other place to go. And the tyranny of numbers also catches up here. If you're a small investor with, say, a few millions of dollars, or perhaps there are people in this audience with or who are going to have a few billions of dollars, you can diversify. You can diversify into euros, gold, a few other things. But once you start talking in the tens or hundreds of billions of dollars, it turns out there is no market out there that is big enough and deep enough to be able to absorb this amount of liquidity. So the dollar it is. So in the last few minutes, let me talk about how the world perhaps ought to be, because the world I've laid out so far, again, seems very odd. It seems like it ought to be a very fragile and dangerous equilibrium. So what should a better world look like? Now, one possibility, again, given that we economists believe that competition is a good thing, is perhaps to have a multiple currency world, where perhaps the US dollar has to coexist with the euro and with the Chinese renminbi all as important reserve currencies. That would certainly have some beneficial effects, because then the US would not be able to run amok with its policies. If it did that, people would go to the euro or Japan for safety, and the US would be forced to pay much higher yields on its government bonds, which would act as a disciplining device. So that is one possibility, but then one may have to ask a much more fundamental question. Why do we have reserve currencies at all? And we have reserve currencies because, as I argued earlier, emerging market countries in particular want a safe place to park their money, because they don't have very well-developed financial systems. Some of their policies create turmoil in those countries. So they have a demand for financial safe assets. If you had financial institutions that did not require financial safe assets because they were better regulated and they didn't have the incentives that forced them to take on a lot of risks for the sake of short-term profit, maybe we wouldn't need reserves. So it's fairly clear, if you were starting with a blank slate, what we might wish for in this kind of world. We might wish for countries to have better domestic policies and a better mix of policies, fiscal and better structural policies, you know, better labor and product markets, better financial markets, so that they don't have to rely so much on monetary policy to keep their economies afloat, which is the case not just in the US, but in many other advanced and emerging market economies. In emerging markets, maybe you'd have financial markets that, when money comes in from abroad, can be nicely intermediated into long-term productive investments, into infrastructure, into other productivity-enhancing investments that creates much less turmoil in financial markets. Maybe you would have an institution, and there are some alums of the International Monetary Fund here where I used to work, and maybe one could have an institution like the IMF that emerging markets actually trusted. Right now, they don't trust it because they still see it as largely being run by and for the benefit of the advanced economies. So they feel that they have to basically accumulate reserves in order to protect themselves, rather than going hat in hand to the IMF at times of distress. So that would be the ideal world. But the reality is that we don't live in that ideal world. There are financial market imperfections. Policies in the advanced economies and the emerging markets are not in the ideal balance, so we need reserve currencies. And then let me leave you with one final paradoxical thought, which is back to the US. Now, I've argued that maybe a better world is one where one has multiple currencies sort of balancing each other. But think back to the financial crisis. What may have made it a lot worse is if there wasn't one currency, one central bank that the world was willing to put its trust in, because there was a real crisis of confidence when the financial crisis hit. We didn't know what to believe in. And if there were multiple reserve currencies, maybe we would have more difficulty finding one that we all trusted. Because when the crisis hit, it turns out the demand around the world was for US dollars. Even banks like the Bank of England, the European Central Bank, came to the US and took dollars from the Federal Reserve because their own banks or financial institutions needed dollars. So it's not very encouraging to end a lecture with this notion that it could have been worse, but that is the reality, that it could have been worse if we didn't have the dollar in its anchor role. But I should emphasize here that I am not telling a story of American exceptionalism. This is not flag waving for the US. The US has policies that I've argued here and elsewhere are muddled in many ways. But the key point is that in international finance, everything is relative. And relatively speaking, the sort of magic sauce that the US has concocted, very deep financial markets, an enormously large economy, institutions that the world seems to trust, that is going to be very difficult for the world to replicate. China, if it goes on its present track, maybe in 20 years, they will have financial markets that could match the US. Will they have the institutions? Building institutions that domestic and foreign investors trust could take a generation, although the Chinese, once they put their mind to do it, may do it in half a generation. But still, that takes a lot of time. So for the moment, unless we can get things squared up in terms of domestic policies and international policies, maybe it's not such a bad thing to have one currency and one central bank, again, that the world seems to be willing to trust. So unless we can change the world dramatically in terms of domestic policies, financial regulatory policies, and the governance structure of international financial institutions, I think we're pretty much stuck in The Dollar Trap. Thank you.
In view of your, is this on? In view of your concern about inflation blowing up this scenario, and the fact that the Federal Reserve is required the dual purpose of full employment and fighting inflation, and now seems to be moving towards a more full employment issue, how do you see the political issue that that presents showing itself over the next year or two or three as it relates to your thesis that inflation could be a major problem for the dollar?
So if there was a burst in inflation, that would certainly hurt the dollar. But in financial markets, expectations are very important, because if there was a good reason to believe that there is going to be inflation in the future, it would be reflected in inflation and bond prices today. So in fact, if you look at any markets and what the markets are telling us, not just today's bond prices, but prices of bonds, where the Treasury inflation protected securities, where effectively the US Treasury is betting against you that it will keep inflation to moderate levels, all of those suggest that nobody seriously believes that there is going to be a burst in inflation, at least nobody who's willing to put their money on the table. And that, I think, is the confidence that the rest of the world still has. But one issue when you think about your question and its implications for foreign investors is curious. And again, this heightens the paradox. It turns out that the U.S. dollar before the financial crisis was actually gradually depreciating against other major currencies. And even over the last 5 years, I said the dollar's value today is roughly where it was 5 years ago. There have been ups and downs. The ups are when there is trouble anywhere in the world. The dollar perks up, and then markets settle down and the dollar starts depreciating. And we economists, for whatever that's worth, believe that the dollar's depreciation over the long run is actually good for the U.S. economy and good for the world economy, because the U.S. has been consuming a lot, is still running a large trade deficit relative to the rest of the world, and a depreciation of the dollar would be good for the dollar in terms of adjusting the U.S. consumption patterns and for the rest of the world. But from the point of view of the rest of the world, this means they're paying a very high price for protection. So if you think about China putting money in U.S. Treasury securities, the rates of return that they're getting, what's the technical term, are piddling. Second, they face the prospect of the renminbi appreciating against the dollar. So they are paying a lot for protection. India is paying a lot for protection. But this is, again, the world we live in. There is so much turmoil that countries around the world seem willing pay this huge price in order to protect themselves. Do you mind if we alternate? Yes, please.
Hi, very much looking forward to reading your book. And I'm going to ask you a question that probably isn't your area of expertise, but maybe you'll take a stab at it. China is sending so much of their money here to the U.S., but they have so many things that they need to do in their own country. I know they're already in, you know, they're investing a lot in infrastructure, a lot in the environment. You know, they're doing a lot of green projects. Why are they not putting more of that money there? Why are they bringing it here, investing it here?
That actually was a question very much in the ambit of my book. In fact, authors of books are a little boring. No matter what question you ask them, they say, it's in the book. This one actually is in the book. I was on a BBC live radio show, and for some reason, the subject turned to women's hair, and I was asked about my opinion on women's hair. So at least this one is in the book. In China's case, it turns out it's not so much for protection as the fact that they've relied on an export-oriented growth strategy. So they wanted to prevent their currency from appreciating. And to do that, you basically intervene in foreign exchange markets, buy dollars so that your currency doesn't appreciate. You basically buy dollars, sell your own currency. But for a country like India, it is protection. And India certainly has very large infrastructure investment needs. If you think about other emerging markets, they certainly have a lot of poor they could use the money for. But the difficulty that they face and the issue that means a lot to them is that these policymakers have been scarred by the crises that hit them during the 80s and 90s. And crises tend to be very, very painful events. So what we are seeing is essentially countries that are willing to pay a very high price for protection knowing that it is going to cost them in terms of their own development objectives, knowing that it's going to cost them real money in some sense, in order to prevent that truly disastrous outcome. So this is a sad reflection at one level about the fact that they have to do this by accumulating reserves because their policies are not great. They're subject to whiplash by actions of the Fed and other central banks, and there is no institution they feel they can turn to for protection.
Thank you.
I found what you said very interesting because the trap is much, your thesis is much worse than what you would think. It isn't good news because it's really $5 trillion of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac paper on top of the $17 trillion. So you got 20. So we basically having a reserve currency that's fiat. We're basically like everybody has $150 million trust fund, and the reserve currencies infantilize the public, the consumers, and the government, and has allowed us to run $10 trillion trade deficits, allow us to run these federal deficits, and the only restraint on us is whether the Germans, get their, hold Europe together, and whether the Chinese stay on or come apart. There's no restraint, so that we know that anything can't go on forever. It's a very, your thesis is very, is troubling because it means that when this ends, it's going to end with a bang. It's not going to end with a whimper.
So that's an observation that seems logically correct because the world has so much of the U.S. Treasury. Surely there might be a time when people start worrying about this. But I argue in the book that, in fact, what is a very curious equilibrium has become a sort of stable and self-reinforcing equilibrium because the numbers you mentioned are very important here. It's about $5.7 trillion worth of treasury securities, some other government paper, and a lot of other dollar-denominated assets that the world holds. So if the dollar plunges in value, if you think about U.S. liabilities to the rest of the world, these are all in dollars. So the U.S. doesn't have to pay any more in dollars. And we can print dollars here in the U.S., so the burden is not that great. But the rest of the world suffers a huge loss. Because if you think about the fall in the dollar's value, the other currencies appreciate against it. So in terms of, say, renminbi, the amount of renminbi you would get for the given amount of dollars is going to be much less. Likewise for India. So in that sense, now the world has a very strong incentive not to let the dollar equilibrium come apart. And that's sort of why we see this very strange phenomenon. For instance, when Standard & Poor's downgraded U.S. government debt. Now, again, in virtually every country, when you have a downgrading of debt, the interest rates rise and the bond prices fall. And what happened in the U.S.? Right after S&P downgraded U.S. debt, bond yields fell. I mean, this is truly remarkable. And why is it? Because people were concerned that there was going to be big trouble. After all, if U.S. government debt, the safest instrument in the world, is downgraded, what else is there to turn to for safety? Oh, my God, I better find a safe place to put my money. What's a safe place? U.S. treasuries, because there's nothing else. And again, as small investors, maybe we can find alternatives. But now we are in a situation, this is why I think the crisis was really a game changer just in terms of the amounts involved and the huge increase in the demand for safety and the decline of the supply. So I don't see an easy way out of this.
Since you're from you used to work at the IMF, let me ask a kind of a different question. The classic IMF response to a situation like Greece, a situation like us, where people have overborrowed, the government has overborrowed, and there's a big trade deficit, and there's a trade deficit, there's an internal deficit, there's deficits wherever you look. And the IMF response has traditionally been, you reduce government spending, you reduce pensions, you reduce wages, so the prices of the goods go down and the trade balance goes away as you export your way out of the trouble. And the most successful economies in the world today are Germans and Chinese, and they're both export-led economies. Is the IMF, if we were to adopt an IMF-type policy here, and question whether you would recommend that, you know, reduction of Social Security, no increase in wages, reduction of government spending. That's what conservatives are recommending. Wouldn't you end up in a situation of competitive devaluations, just like in the Depression? Everybody can't have export-led growth at the same time. And the only models of real growth that we've seen have been export-led growth.
So President Obama, in his State of the Union address 3 years ago, said that he wanted to double U.S. exports in 5 years. In that speech, there isn't a single mention of the word currency, which to us economists is remarkable because, again, it's hard to imagine such an increase in U.S. exports without the currency depreciating. And again, there is this curious machismo in the U.S. Of course, every Treasury Secretary has to say strong dollar. In fact, I have some interesting quotes in the book about how Paul O'Neill, after he was after we finished his term as Treasury Secretary, while he was Treasury Secretary, he did say strong dollar after he left. He said, you know, I kept having to say strong dollar. It was the silliest thing I had to say, but it made sense. And Alan Greenspan, again, this is something in the book, he says that he used to cringe when he heard Robert Rubin recite this mantra. But then he said, I came to like it because it didn't mean anything. It was completely vacuous, but it kept the press completely silent. So I really began to like the slogan. Now, what you're pointing to is a very difficult and fraught issue because right now every major economy, advanced or emerging market, is relying on monetary policy to do all the heavy lifting. And monetary policy does have spillovers. And if you think about the Bank of Japan, for instance, they say that they are trying to use monetary policy expansion to stimulate the economy. But the U.S. says try to do it without letting your currency depreciate. And the whole point of Japan doing this is to let the currency depreciate. So I don't see an easy way out of this. In fact, I have a piece in the Asian Wall Street Journal today, which points out that we are going to have rising currency tensions for precisely this issue. If you think about what the U.S. ought to be doing on fiscal policy, clearly we could be doing a lot. But I think we're getting it backwards. I think in the short run, perhaps we should be providing a little more support to the recovery and dealing with the longer-term problems, which I think everybody agrees is necessary for long-term fiscal sustainability, but that's politically very fraught. And my sense is that, unfortunately, the short-term fiscal discipline we are imposing in the U.S. is not good for long-term growth and productivity. One might have a sensible argument about what the right level of expenditures and revenue is, but cutting to the bone expenditures on education, productivity, surely on infrastructure and so forth, is surely not good for long-term productivity. So I fear we are getting it a little backwards on fiscal policy, not dealing with the long-term problem, because, again, the world is not disciplining the U.S. enough. And even in the U.S., as is true in many other countries, I think structural policies, including, say, in the U.S. tax reform, even if we want to keep the level of taxes exactly the same, and we can again have a recent discussion about that, just reforming the system that we have right now, and as somebody who just finished his tax returns and lived through the agony of that, I'm sure many of you are dealing with it as well, can tell you that we need a better tax system that doesn't distort incentives so much. So there is a lot to be done on the structural front, but we continue relying on the Fed. And that, I think, is a real problem. Yes.
This is all very provocative, and there are a couple things that come together. One unifying strand is everything's relative. I think we understand that, as you've explained it. It's interesting that when reference is made to conservative policies and IMF policies, why the first thing is, you know, reduce Social Security, cut back on education, and so on and so forth. It's not, what are we going to do about Wall Street? don't cut that. That's not the first thing that comes out of everybody's mouth. It's all these public services. And then you said, you know, well, we can print money. And that's true. And when we had to print money for Wall Street, which was reckless, and the mortgage industry, which was reckless, we just printed money and printed it, and we're still just printing money. So at least as far as monetary policy goes, if we're not going to go, and I don't think we are, back to a gold standard, is there some way in which money through policy means could be limited such that we really had a strong dollar?
Yeah, so normal economics would tell you that if you have more money chasing the same amount of goods, prices should rise and start rising faster. The reason that's not happening right now is because the financial system is gummed up and there is a lack of demand. So that means that prices are not rising as fast as they normally would. So as we begin to see a normalization of the economy and the labor market, for all its problems, is beginning to show some signs of strength. We are now back to roughly the level of private sector employment that we had back in 2007, which is not a big victory by any means, but given where we were even about a year and a half ago, this is certainly significant progress. So I think once that kicks in, you will start seeing wage and price pressures building up. And it's sort of in anticipation of that, the Fed has already started pulling back on its quantitative easing operations. And I think many economists, including myself, think that early next year, we will start seeing a bit of a normalization of the interest rate cycle as the economy recovers and as price pressures begin to pick up. So there is, again, given the Fed's dual mandate, there is very strong confidence, and I think for good reason, that the Fed will do what it takes in order to keep inflation at moderate levels. Mm-hmm. This could become a very tricky balancing act if something goes wrong with the taper. But again, for better or worse, we all seem to have faith that the Fed can do this. And whether that faith is going to be misplaced, we'll have to see. But certainly the fact that the world is willing to come to the U.S. even during our time of distress makes it a lot easier. There was some discussion about IMF policy. If you think about, say, IMF policies towards Greece, certainly one can argue that in many ways it's heartless, or IMF policies towards Ukraine now, the poor country is suffering and the IMF is asking them to do certain things. And I stand here not as an apologist for IMF policies, but what the IMF is basically asking these countries to do is what is needed for them to be able to finance themselves. Because these countries are losing access to international finance, which they need in order to keep going. So what the IMF goes in and says, it'll give you a chunk of money, but we cannot finance you forever. And if you don't do these things, you're going to be in pretty deep trouble. And that's the reality for many of these economies. You don't go hat in hand to the IMF willingly until you're in very deep trouble. And at that stage, very painful things have to be done because they have been postponed for a very long time. And certainly the ability to print money makes it less likely for the U.S. to have to do this, or even take Japan. Japan actually, relative to the size of its economy, has even more debt, way more debt than the U.S. But they are not under big pressure because much of that debt is domestically owned. So they're not subject to the whims of foreign investors as much. But still, it has negative effects on the U.S., on the Japanese economy to have this debt burden coming up for future generations, especially with the declining population. But these are countries, again, where the quality of the institutions definitely seems to matter in terms of maintaining the faith.
Well, if I may just follow up, what you're saying is consistent. You're saying that as the when and if another crisis presents itself or looms, then it's a judgment question on the part of monetary managers as to how to avoid or mitigate it. And my question had to do with whether there's a policy approach we could take to the dollar that would give us even greater confidence, because after all, the Fed fouled up. I mean, they helped get us into this terrible last 5 years.
So it is true that one can implicate Fed regulatory policies in particular for causing the troubles we ended up in. But since that happened, actually, the Fed has, in some sense, filled the void, because there has been a real policy void. And we would be in far worse shape today if the Fed had not acted so aggressively. And it is true from the Fed's point of view, and they've been candid about this, that there was a very delicate juggling of the balance of risks and benefits. And the Fed was in completely uncharted waters, but felt that it had to do everything it could because other policies were not functioning. And again, it's not just the Fed, it's the Bank of Japan, it's the European Central Bank. All of these central banks are sort of making up for the failings of other policies. which puts even more of a burden on the central banks. So I think the right response here again would be to think about what is the right mix of policies so that monetary policy can go back to being somewhat more normal. And the difficulty we have is that the other policies are not being fixed. So monetary policy continues to carry the burden. And that I see as a real danger. In the case of the US, the danger is more limited because of the fact that although we may not be very happy with how far financial market regulations have moved forward, there has been some increase in safety. And I think some of the risks that were in the financial system before the crisis have been weakened. This is not to say there aren't massive risks out there still, but we are in a better spot today than we were 5 years ago. And to some extent, I think it's because of the Fed's aggressive actions.
Thank you.
I find the title of your book very intriguing. And if I can play devil's advocate and ask you a couple of questions about it. To have a trap, it has to be designed and built. And second, if you're going to do that, you're going to have a purpose in mind. So would you mind addressing those two angles of the question?
So that's the pushback I get in the US in particular is about the notion of a trap, because I hear from government officials this notion like you're saying that somehow we created this trap in the world, we sucked the poor world into it. Many people in the US argue that, look, it's just the fact that the world is all messed up and they're coming to us for safety and we're giving them what they need. So this is not really something that we have designed as a way of trapping them. But again, one might argue that if you buy my book's thesis that the financial crisis was a game changer, in a sense, that is what really cemented this trap.
Yes.
Not sure if the right metaphor to cement a trap, but you get the idea. That's when the trap became really a bit of a chokehold on the rest of the world, given this enormous supply-demand imbalance that developed after the crisis. So one might argue that given that the crisis started here, it's not that the US willingly did this, of course, but it was an important byproduct of the financial crisis, because that exposed the weaknesses in the Eurozone that created this excess demand for financial safe assets. This substantially eroded the safety of private sector securities. So all of this really tightened the trap to a significant extent. But again, right now, it's not that the US is keeping anybody here. The US has given everybody the perfect freedom because it's a very liquid market to move away. And one might argue, in fact, that I said that when Standard & Poor's downgraded U.S. debt, that money flew into the U.S. So for you and me, with small investors, it might make perfect sense to go there, not because we think U.S. government bonds are safe, but because it's a very liquid market. Mm-hmm. So we might say, this is a good place to put money. When the storm blows over, all right, I might lose a little bit of money, but that's okay, because my principal is preserved. So it may really be a flight to liquidity rather than safety. But for the central banks of the world, which are talking in tens or hundreds of billions of dollars, there is no escape. Because once you get in here, if China in the last half of last year alone, China accumulated about $320 billion worth of foreign exchange reserves. And although the official data don't show this because of the way things are handled through certain custodial accounts, almost certainly a large fraction of that came here, because there is no other market that can absorb that sort of money. So this is, I think, a situation that is not necessarily one where the U.S. has sort of tried to ensnare the rest of the world. And to some extent, as I said, it's a reflection not just of superior U.S. policies, but weaknesses in the rest of the world and in the international monetary system. So again, it could have been a lot worse, but for the U.S.
Quick follow-up. What happened to all of the pundits in the early part of this century that were predicting the decline of the dollar? Because as you mentioned, that's been arrested. In fact, the dollar may have strengthened vis-a-vis.
There are, the last chapter of my book starts with this quote from this very famous monetary economist, Robert Triffin, who in 1960 said, we have to prepare for the imminent death of the dollar. And every few years, the imminent death of the dollar is predicted. And so far, it's not happened. There are times, certainly, when the dollar looked like it was in trouble. But the dollar has sort of made it through each of those times because, again, there were no alternatives. But here again, the crisis really has been a game changer in terms of the amounts involved, because the amount of debt held by the rest of the world was not quite as large before the crisis, and so much of the debt that we've issued, that the U.S. has issued over the last 6 years, has been bought by the rest of the world, that now it has really become a trap. Because earlier it may have been easier to get out because the amounts involved were smaller, because the demand for safety wasn't as intense, and because there wasn't so much money locked up in U.S. dollars. But now all of that has changed.
Thank you.
So I'm a professor. I can keep talking all night long, but I know that you have lives to lead. So if maybe I'll take one final question if there's anything. Okay, we'll take one last quick question.
Sorry, I already asked one, but somebody mentioned the gold standard. There's no, I know the Republicans were talking about that earlier. There's no way that, I mean, is anybody seriously thinking that that could ever even happen?
So, okay, let me wrap up with two comments on that. One, and since we're talking about gold, why not talk about Bitcoin as well, something that constantly yeah. comes up. The allure about things like gold and Bitcoins is that there is a limited supply. Ultimately, there are going to be only 21 million Bitcoins mined. If you think about gold, there's about 165,000 metric tons above the ground and maybe another 50,000 to 55,000 metric tons below the ground. So you might think that all of these things have limited supply, but ultimately, these are also built on faith. And what is very different in the faith that people place in paper money is that these are backed by a public institution like the Fed, which in turn is backed by a government with the taxing authority. And that is really important if you think about why fiat currencies are unlikely to be displaced. And the other thing we learned, which is also very interesting, going back to this issue of supply, is you might think again that limited supply means you preserve value better. But again, what the financial crisis showed us is that the asset that turned out to be the most valuable in the financial crisis was not the one in limited supply, but the one that could be supplied essentially infinitely by the Fed. Because that proved to be the sort of mechanism that got us out, because the world wanted liquidity and the dollar was something that everybody was willing to trust and accept. So again, one might argue that this is an almost childlike faith in the U.S. dollar. But there is a reason for that faith to be on slightly firmer bedrock than, say, something like gold or Bitcoin, that you do have an institution like the central bank, which in turn is backed by a taxing authority. And given the state of modern finance with this need for liquidity, I think the gold standard would be such a constraining thing that it doesn't make sense. Again, we will see the price of gold perhaps rising because people are desperate for safety and they are desperate for alternatives. So we will have the price of gold perhaps rising over time. But I think it's going to be very difficult to displace fiat currencies in any real sense. So you've been very patient. I hope I haven't I've provoked you but not given you too many thoughts that will keep you awake at night. But thank you very much for coming.